Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to our Bible study. Today we'll be reading Matthew chapter 11. As you grab your Bibles, a couple notes. Our goal is to show you that you can resurrect that time-honored tradition of sitting around reading the Bible and then discussing it. Along the way, we would like to equip you for the road ahead with what the Bible taught us about life and what life has taught us about the Bible. If you'd like to be a part of what we're doing, then go forth and make disciples, fellowship in the Bible study, pray for each other and for us. All right, who is reading first?
I am. My name is Greg. And I'm reading from a New King James Version, and I'm going to read chapter 11, verses 1 through 10. Now it came to pass, when Jesus finished commanding his 12 disciples, that he departed from there to teach and preach in their cities. And when John had heard, that's John the Baptist, when John had heard in prison about the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to him, "Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and tell John the things which you hear and see. The blind see, and the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them, and blessed is he who is not offended because of me." As they departed, Jesus began to say to the multitudes concerning John, "What did you see? What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, he who will prepare your way before you.'"
I'm Mark, and I'm going to read, pick it up here at verse 11 and read through verse 19. I'm also reading from the New King James Version. "Assuredly, I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist. But he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to receive it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to what shall I liken this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their companions and saying, 'We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We mourned to you, and you did not lament. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a winebibber, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. But wisdom is justified by her children.'"
And I'm Lowell, and I'm going to be reading, continuing in Matthew 11 at verse 20, reading from the New American Standard Translation. "Then he began to denounce the cities in which most of his miracles were done because they did not repent. 'Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles had occurred in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. Nevertheless, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the day of judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will descend to Hades, for if the miracles had occurred in Sodom, which occurred in you, it would have remained to this day. Nevertheless, I say to you that it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for you." At that time, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for this way was well-pleasing in your sight. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. And no one knows the Son except the Father, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light."
All right, let's go with first impressions. I'm still forming mine in my head. So,
I'm going to make a comment here. I mean, right off, of course, this chapter is talking about who really is this Christ. You know, I mean, that was the question on everybody. Who is he? Even John, you know, I think John was in a little kind of state of flux in the sense that it wasn't coming out quite as he thought it should be or would be. And so he's got questions, but I think he's pretty solid. But so he's pushing, he's testing, he's without really not knowing what answer he's going to get. And so the whole thing is, and then I'm very much enamored with why this chapter ends where it did. So
the thing that strikes me is these cities where Jesus had performed so many signs and wonders.
Yeah.
He rebukes them for disbelief. And there's a strain of Christendom that believes that you have to have ongoing signs, wonders, miraculous manifestations in order to maintain faith. But I feel that when you come to know the Lord and when you come to see him for who he is, your faith focuses on him, not on events or phenomenon or things that are like a leaky tire, have to keep pumping up your faith. So that's one of the things that stood out to me is his words to these people who should have really known who he is.
And of course, nowadays there is there's another strain or group of brothers and sisters who don't hold to any miraculous events anymore. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think they would insist, and they do insist, that their focus is on the Word, and on we have the whole Bible now available to us to testify to those things that those signs that were meant to signal the Lord Jesus and his authority and the fact that indeed he's the Son of God. I don't know, I would just set that aside, and don't want to enter into that bit of controversy, if there is controversy around it. I think picking up on what Greg said, though, the fact that the Lord ends here with the message, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." That's something that those who were focused on the miracles, it seems like they were missing out on. They weren't seeing Jesus. They didn't see him, for they were looking past him and not hearing what he really had to say to them.
Christianity is not a freak show.
Well, I want to zoom out a little bit. At chapter 11, the heading of this chapter in my New King James is opposition to Jesus. This really isn't a chapter about the opposition to Jesus. This is going right in verse 1. It is departed from there to teach and to preach in their cities. So this is some of the preaching that's happening in those cities. And John's disciples jump with him and ask him the question. Launches him into this great monologue, which I don't know if it's a composite of several different things he did or one big sermon, because he does jump targets, I should say, same subject matter. So as I zoom out, this is chapter 11, and this is five chapters of Jesus's words. And as I kind of went back through that, there's three different categories for Jesus in the book of Matthew. Each chapter kind of falls into that. There's him lining up with the messianic text, there's him doing his miracles, and then there's him preaching. We just left off him preaching, him instructing his disciples on what to do as they leave. And then we get into this, people doubt him. And here's what he's doing about that. So.
Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, I think, you know, I'm going to just add one more thought then. You know, everybody's got to get to know who he is. And it's not what he does so much as who he is, because what he does comes out of who he is.
Well, on that, you know, that ties into what I'm going to bring up is in, I think, verse 19 is lesson for John's disciples, I should call it. wrapped up with wisdom is justified by her children. So that ties into that greatly. It's not just the miracles, the whole tie-in is children of what Jesus, you know, wisdom is justified by her children. The fruits of what Jesus has done and what John has done here is very evident.
Can I back up to the first six verses there?
Sure, that was my first, that was my opening impression. So yeah, now we can get into the verses.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, where John sends, you know, messengers to Jesus, and he has a question, the serious question. Are you the expected one, or shall we look for someone else? Why does he have that question? He was the great harbinger of the Messiah. He prepared the way of the Messiah. That was his whole ministry. But he's having doubts, and I think it's an important thing to see this, because we all have expectations and anticipations when we become a Christian or when we believe in God. And there are things that do not work out as we anticipated. John ushered in and made the way for the Messiah to come and be recognized. And he winds up in a jail cell. And we know that he's going to be beheaded in that jail cell. And our expectations may not be fulfilled. And the Lord knows that that's going to happen. But he speaks the highest recognition of John the Baptist, and he specifically says, of those born of woman, among those born of woman. And, God did not let him down, and he has his esteem and his reward that is sure.
Why, thank you, Dad, for giving me something that something I've been thinking about that this launches into perfectly. John's question here mirrors Satan's. We brought up back in chapter 4, I believe, if you are the Son of God, do this. John has a similar question, not with the disrespect Satan has, but it is a very good question. And something I thought about with that is going back to the Garden of Eden, to the question to Eve, it was, did God really say? Mm-hmm. And there are people who get offended when people ask questions about the gospel. What the horrible part of those stories is the fact that Eve did not answer, yes, God said, my husband told me, God said, do not eat of that tree. So this, I guess my real complaint is when people say, well, Satan asked the same question, they use that as a cover for not being able to answer it. Question in front of it. So when John here asks, are you the coming one or do we look for another? Jesus turns and answers the question directly. Okay. Doesn't evade and doesn't hem and haw on it and doesn't look for an excuse.
But he didn't say yes.
Yeah, he didn't.
Well, he said yes just in that word.
What's that?
Well, he said yes, but by, well, what do your eyes say?
Yeah, right. It is an answer by not being a really direct answer. Mm-hmm. Because it makes you think. If you just answer point blank and say, yeah, I'm the guy, there's no... You don't have a lot in there. He's going to just talk about, what have I been doing?
Is it later in Matthew that they ask the people? No, it's the Sanhedrin, I believe, that asks, well, if the Messiah is coming, can he do more than this guy?
Yes.
The Sanhedrin or the people, right. Forget that.
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, bringing it back on to the personal level, we all go through our things that cause us to really question if we're in God's will or if God's really faithful to us.
Right.
But the way that Jesus answered the question is the way that we can answer it. On my worst day, I can ask, who else died for me that I can have the hope of eternal life, regardless of what's going on in my life right now? And we have the answer to that question. Our relationship with God is not circumstantial. Our relationship with God is substantial. And he will never let us down, and no matter what particular things we must go through, he will get us through, and he will be faithful.
You know, recently, over these last quite a while, very often in the morning, after I've walked through the previous day and waking up and recall what the day was, this, I can't quote you the verse, but it says, it's of the Lord's mercies that I'm not consumed. And that is, you know, I've never had it so strong. I've never had it so strong. I mean, you know, I've been a Christian 50 years now. And, you know, our expectations of ourselves and where we're going to be, especially when I was a young guy, you know, they were high. We're going to, you know, even the group I was with, you know, we were thinking, oh man, you know, the Lord's coming just around the corner, you know, all kinds of stuff. But, you know, it's the process of coming to know Him and what is the real meaning of life? What is the essence of, you know, humanity and existence in this created world, universe? So anyway, there.
The other thing on John the Baptist is Jesus more questions. And Jesus asked the crowd, you know, why did you go out in the wilderness to see a reed shaken by the wind, you know, a man in soft clothing? John the Baptist was no wimp. He was a man's man. And he told it like it is. And he was hated and reviled by religious people, but he called them snakes. He told it like it is. And he took it like a man.
I want to jump off that really quick. John asked a serious question about Jesus' identity and whether he performed the duties. Jesus did not turn this into a John bashing session. I take your attention to modern politics right now. You do not see that. You do not see this humility in the leader where he says, this guy asked a very serious question about me, of my authenticity, and he's a great guy. Jesus sees nothing but his praises.
Yeah.
For the work he's done. He does not belittle him.
Yeah.
He doesn't say he's dumb, he's wrong. But he lifts him up. He's like, this is one of the greatest men ever.
Right.
You know this.
So he does recognize that, he recognizes that John is asking the question in good faith.
Yeah.
However, you know, he's in a corner. I mean, he's in a jail cell.
Yeah.
But he asks the question in good faith, and Jesus recognizes that.
Yeah.
You know, he recognizes when the Pharisees and Sadducees have an agenda behind the question they put to him. And so thus the answers he provides them as compared to here, the answer that he gives John.
He doesn't condemn him for doubt.
Right.
Just like Abram. God didn't condemn him for doubt. He just encountered him and renewed his faith. So
how about verse 12? Let's question there here. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence and the violent take it by force. I'd like to hear some of you guys' thoughts on that.
I think it's evidenced in John's life as Herod has him beheaded. And, you know, going back to the history of Israel with the four empires that conquered Israel and dominated Israel. And I think Jesus is saying that just as a window for the new thing that's going to take place, is the kingdom that's coming cannot be dominated by the powers of the world.
My take on it is that those who are really taking hold of the kingdom of heaven here under the Lord's direction and leadership, that they're having to do it with opposition from religious leaders, and so it's not something they can do lightly.
Ask the question, you got to have the answer.
Oh, I'm trying to tie this into what we also see in verse 16, because it sounds like that is part of the answer to the question you asked, Dad, and from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. Then he runs it, but what shall I like in this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their companions and saying, we played the flute for you, but you did not dance, we mourned for you, and you did not lament. And when somebody brings you the unabashed truth like John the Baptist did, there isn't time for false emotion. That makes sense. People stirring up emotions. I think there's something there. I haven't been able to phrase it correctly.
Yeah. You know, Josh, that triggers me a little bit in that, you know, he's clearly saying there's two opposing reactions. Mm-hmm. But those reactions are based upon their concept of who he was supposed to be. And, you know, their expectation was, well, we played the flute, you didn't dance, we mourned, you didn't lament. And, you know, he's using himself, John the Baptist himself, you know, here's how we came. And, you know, it's contradictory. It's, you know, these are two opposing views. And so I think, it is all coming back to that question. Are you the coming one or do we look for another? They're questioning from their reference points and how they thought they understood the Old Testament prophecy and all that kind of stuff as to who this guy is supposed to be. And he's not kind of doing it like we thought.
Yeah.
You know, and so, and, you know, it's very interesting. The Lord played with that a lot. Not in a bad sense, but he wouldn't allow people that all of a sudden when their eyes got open, he wouldn't allow them to go out and say he's the Christ. He told them, in fact, he told some of the demons, you know, they started proclaiming in the middle of one of his things he was doing, and he says, silent, you know. He's forcing issues with everybody as to who he is. And if you don't come to know him on his terms and his conditions, you are not going to know who he really is.
Yeah. Here's what I read on it is, I think the Lord answers that in verse 13, which ties into the what he says later. He says, for all the prophets and law prophesied until John. What's prophets and law? That's an expression of the Old Testament. That's what Hebrews at that time called what we call the Old Testament scripture, the law and the prophets.
Yeah.
And then Jesus goes into this dissertation about, you know, the Old Testament showed our sin. And so, you know, we sang a dirge and you did not mourn. And so the people did not respond to the Old Testament prophets. And he says, now in the New Testament, we played the flute for you and you didn't dance. People are not going to respond to what God is doing no matter what. And here comes freedom and life. And people say, you know, we don't want to dance. We don't want to be happy.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me jump off Greg there really quick, because and else I've been chewing on. Old YouTube videos of people asking questions and about God. One of the questions that popped up a few times is, why can't God accept me for who I am? What we see here is Jesus asking the exact same thing. Why can't people accept me for who I am? Why must they dictate when I'm dancing, when I am to say the dirge? This is Jesus.
So I that makes me think of the song that was played by if you ever went to a Billy Graham crusade, just as I am, Lord, my plea is I'm a sinner and I need salvation. I need the Lord Jesus. And that's really what's going in. Someone who asked that question, why can't you accept me as I am? Well, are you a sinner? The Lord is here to save you from your sin. And that's where you begin. Here, it's just the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they looked at John the Baptist and said, as they didn't respect his dressing in coarse clothing and eating just honey from the comb and bugs as though it were some kind of a sacrifice or a ceremonial practice. And neither did they respect the Lord Jesus when he, you know, saved Zacchaeus from out of a tree and went to eat in his house with a bunch of other tax collectors and sinners. And
Matthew too.
Pardon?
Matthew.
Yeah, Matthew too. Uh-huh. Right. So, you know, they had their filters on, their blinders on, in every situation, and they just weren't seeing Jesus for who he was, and they couldn't bring themselves to get outside of their own
situations,
their boxes.
Yeah. On that note, that's what verse 25 is talking about. when Jesus speaks to the Father and he says, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you've hidden these things from the wise and intelligent and have revealed them to infants. And I have a little sayism, as you don't know what you need to know until you know that you don't know. And people who think they are too smart to be a Christian, or they're not going to fall for that, you know, that silly stuff, will never know, because they think they're smart, and they think they're sophisticated, and they think that they're intellectual. And you know, there's nothing wrong with intelligence. One of the most intelligent people that I follow is Jordan Peterson, who is a psychologist, and he has worked his way to faith in Christ through his great intellect. And there's nothing wrong with intelligence, but there is something wrong with being a sophomore, a wise fool, you know,
who is what sophomore translates to.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Yeah. The audience.
A young moron.
Well, the only thing worse would be an old moron.
Yeah, that's right. My mom used to say there's no fool like an old fool.
Yeah. So in verse 20, you know, and again, I'm really reflecting on this for the first time in this way. I'm just seeing the flow of the passage and why probably Matthew wrote it in the order and stuff, etc. So right after, you know, he talks about the, you know, the flute and the dirge stuff. Then he goes into the rebuke to the cities where he did these things. And so again, there's intimated that, hey, the prophets have been playing this stuff for a long time. And you guys are still ignorant when I, the final prophet just came. His name was John, and I'm here, and you guys aren't doing, you know, you guys aren't doing either. And so he, you know, the rebuke to the cities where most of the mighty works had been done because they did not repent. And so here, you know, if these things would have been done in so-and-so city or the so-and-so city, those people would have repented. So anyway, I think it's flowing really well. I was surprised. That's my point. This whole passage is flowing well.
Can I interject a real quick editorial note, springboarding off of what Greg just said? For those of you that watch this, none of us here have notes. We sit down and read the word, and we learn as we do it. And Greg just had an epiphany in looking at the passage here and have insights. We're not experts. We're just people who like to read the word and share together around it. Encourage you to do that.
Amen. If I had notes, I'd sound a whole lot different. Well, the fun part about what you just said is the epiphanies that keep arising. Is if you had notes, you're kind of stuck on those train tracks all the way through the end, and you don't get to learn the new things and see how the Bible is applied to. As well, let me go back to this thing here, okay? One way would like to equip you for the road ahead with what the Bible's taught us about life and what life is taught about the Bible. We're coming back to this after living a little bit more life, and we're learning new things.
Exactly right. Exactly
right. If I was railroaded, this is the second time I've been through Matthew as a Bible study. If I was railroaded to those old lessons, we would skip these new lessons that are applicable right now.
Yep. Good input.
You know, having rebuked, you know, Bethsaida and Chorazin and so forth, verse 28 has such profound meaning. Jesus does not condemn and reject. He confronts. And then he invites.
That's good.
He says, come to me. And sadly, much of Christendom is conveyed as condemnation and judgmentalism. That is not Christendom. It is proclaiming what is right and inviting people to come to it. It is, you know, recognizing that there's a table set that is sufficient to every person in this world, and recognizing the invitation of Jesus Christ is not the invitation of the church. It's an invitation of the Lord. And the Bible ends with a passage that goes something like, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Heaven is inviting people to a feast.
Amen.
And to a way that is not weary and heavy laden. Life without Christ is weary and heavy laden. Come to him.
I want to key off that really quick because it needs me to zoom out quite a bit. So as we've been going through this last year and a half, relationship has been the key word. But you bring a new key word into, especially the book of Matthew, which is confrontation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very important. Even back in the Sermon on the Mount, he's confrontational with those who are blessed. He shows them, confronts them, they are blessed if they're this way. All through this chapter, there's confrontation after confrontation after confrontation. And that actually leads to better relationships,
yes,
not worse relationships.
Yes.
So if you exist non-confrontational, you're not getting the best out of life. They're called, forget where, iron sharpens iron, so another man sharpens another. It's a confrontation.
In fact, John the Baptist, he was no wimp telling people what they wanted to hear.
Even John the Baptist sending his guys to talk to Jesus, that's a confrontation.
Right.
It would have been easier for him to sit in a cell, think his thoughts of condemnation, and not confront Jesus with his question.
Right. That's exactly right. The Lord can handle our questions.
Yeah. And as followers of our Lord, we need to be able to handle some of them as well.
That's right. Without taking it personally and getting our feelings hurt.
Yeah.
So here's another epiphany.
Good.
The last three verses, very famous, you know, come to me, et cetera, et cetera. But I think he's setting that up, the invitation in whetting their appetite by what he says in verse 27. All things have been delivered to me. You know, he didn't need to say that. But all things have been delivered to me by the Father. No one comes to the Father. Okay. No one comes to know the Son or the Father, you know, unless I do it. The Father does it and I do it. You know, except the Son, the Father. No one knows the Father except the Son, the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. The next statement, come to me. I'll do it. I'll reveal it.
That's right.
Anyway.
That's right. What's it cost you to do that?
Whatever.
Yep. Yeah, go for it.
Spend it. Well worth it.
I've heard so many people who have shared that at some point in their life, they prayed a prayer something like this: Lord, if you are there, make yourself known. He answers that prayer. It's not some complicated theological treatise or some super spiritual dazzling act, but a simple humbling of asking a question, allowing God to answer it.
Yeah, babes.
All right, final thoughts.
Prison of Bethsaida could be me. After all that God has done in my life, why have I not hooked up more and better? And that invitation of the Lord, you know, come to me. And for me to do that, and I suggest that to any listener, to just answer that invitation of Christ and come to him.
So, and don't stop coming.
That's right.
I have to look at the Greek. I like to do that, guys. If somebody's watching this, and I'm kind of a geek on many things. I'm a Greek geek, and I got the equipment to do it, and I'll do it. But, you know, whether it's come and keep coming.
If anybody's got a cell phone, they have the same equipment.
That's right.
Yeah. Oh, no, I think two of those shelves back there are all Greek. So.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, no, look at that. I'm not very neat about it, but I am.
So I guess my final thought would be, so when the Lord issues this invitation to come to him, he says he's going to give us rest. And yet he's talking in terms of a yoke, which is a implement that's used for work, hard work. And it's characteristic of the Lord that he talks a little bit in contradictions and in ways that kind of take us aback. This yoke, it's you yoke together a couple of oxen so that you're able to use them together and double their strength, if you will, by doing so. And here is the Lord saying he's going to yoke himself to us, to me, and I'm going to benefit from his strength and his purpose, such that there's rest. So anyway, just you know, it's not something, a yoke is not something to, with the Lord, it's not something to be stiff-armed, thinking, oh, I don't want that, that's just more work that I'm cut out for. No.
I have an epiphany, Mark.
Let me key off of him really quick, and then we'll go back to you. Thank you, Mark, for actually helping me underline my last thought, because what it says here is, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I'm gentle and lowly in heart. You will find rest for your souls. Like you're saying, the yoke is hard work. This work that Jesus has you do is worthwhile.
That's right.
And that's where you get the rest for your souls. As somebody who's done a lot of non-worthwhile work, this really appeals out to me, because I was going to go back to, but wisdom is justified by her children. And this ties into that, because when you do worthwhile work, you'll have not just offspring, you'll raise up the next generation, you'll raise up the next ones to take your place. We'll introduce others to the yoke of Jesus Christ so that they can do worthwhile work and their souls be restored.
The thing I thought of as Mark was sharing that, the Lord does not say, come and get in my wagon, I will pull you through life.
Right, there you
not
go.
Not what he said.
No, that's right. Not what it says.
Come join him.
Come, and so, and I guess I've never seen this before, but the Lord doesn't say, if you accept me, I'm going to do everything for you in life. We are still responsible people making choices, but the Lord is pulling with us and makes it possible. So, you know, we don't jump on the Christian wagon and ride through life. We walk with the Lord through life.
Yes.
Pulling together.
The word for this book may be confrontation, but the word for this chapter for us is evidently epiphany.
Yep.
All right, who's going to close us out in prayer, gentlemen?
Mark.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go for Mark.
All right. So, Heavenly Father, thank you so much for a corner to corner each and every week, visiting with Josh, looking into your word now in the Gospel of Matthew. Thank you for your spirits leading us through this Bible study. Father, we thank you for Jesus, his love for us, his counsel for us, his challenging us in this life. And we pray in his name. Amen.
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 God bless you, baby.